follow. And I rule the world free. To the east with alarm, to the west with a sea. And I searched high and low, scanned the skies, found it land.
Follow, and Happy New Year to you. And thank you again for all of your love and support. We have grown to the point where we no longer fit in Madison Avenue Crossroads, but they were good to us. So we want to thank the Patterson Housing Authority for allowing us to use their gymnasium. Let's give them a round of applause. Our partners, Mr. Sheriff Richard Burdick. I'm told he was here a little early. He wanted to greet you all at the door. Did you see Sheriff Burdick?
Yes.
Absolutely. And we want to thank our community policing department. I see our former retired undersheriff, Mr. Washington, in the back, and also Jasmine Curry in the back. I also want to thank the Patterson Brown Shield. I saw members from the Patterson Brown Shield. You have to stand up for us. Thank you. Senator Poe, Assemblyman Wimberly, myself, and our staff, we enjoy this event because it's a time for us to say thank you to you all for the shoulders that we stand on. It's a time for us to fellowship and break bread and have a little laughter. It's a time for me to test out my vocal skills. And same with the Tech Tones. This year, since the Tech dancers could not show, Assemblyman Wimberly is going to do a pop lock. So if anyone, you know, wants to add a swing or a hustle to that, please feel free to do that. But as the years go by, we've had different experiences. This has been 5 years of service for the Assemblyman and I. We were just re-elected, thanks to you all, to our third terms. Let's give that a round of applause. And I just want to remind you all that the Assemblyman, in a 218-year history, is the third African-American male to serve as the Assemblyman representing Patterson in 218 years. He is also now the Deputy Speaker of the General Assembly, and Vice Chair of Telecommunications. And his four boys, his wife, his community service, coaching, his job as a teacher, and all those other great things. So we work hard, and we work hard because you all mean a lot to us. It means a lot for us to know that we're representing your needs, making sure that we see your faces in Trenton. When you talk about cuts to programs, that mean a lot to us. On your table, you'll see the senior freeze information. If you are a homeowner, I talk to too many of you whose property taxes continue to go up, but your income is not going up, and you're worried about your name being in the paper for not paying your taxes, and somebody buying your taxes, and then you're having to pay a premium to purchase that. So please call that number, see if there's some assistance that you can receive. Most of you have heard or have read that I said I am considering running for governor, and that part is true, and I need your prayer. I need our community's needs to be reflected in all of these decisions that are being made that's impacting our pocketbooks, impacting the future for these children. So it's important that we work together. Before the Assemblyman speaks, or you want to speak first? We want to take some time, because as years go by, there are faces of loved ones that are not with us here today. And we lost another member in addition to a host of them throughout the 5 years that we've been here in office. And we'd like to take a moment of silence for Reverend Allen, who passed away recently. So if you'll please just bow your heads and let's give him a moment of silence. Thank you. And with that said, I'm going to turn it over to my Assemblyman before we hear the sounds of Sage County Tech Tones. Assemblyman.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I thought I was being brought up because I was going to dance while you guys sang this morning. But I'm waiting for my outfit to come in once my outfit gets here. I figured I'd do a little praise dancing or a little pop locking for you this morning to get going. But I really want to commend, I really want to commend our assemblywoman, who I believe is the second black assemblywoman of the 35th District, represent obviously after Denise Evans. I commend the assemblywoman for really organizing this. I'm really just coming out and, you know, show support. And the key thing is that her leadership has been outstanding. Many of you don't know or do know now is that she is the assembly conference leader, which means she's in one of our people that represent us. If you watched Channel 8 yesterday, she was representing us there, and she represents the city of Paris as well, be it, you know, labor, be it education. I don't care what area it is, she doesn't have to serve on committee. And the one thing that she really hit on the point is, we were at an educational rally this morning for the Patterson Public Schools and public education overall. The one thing I say on Black History Month, please give your young folks a lesson, a real Black history. Give your folks a lesson. And when I say that, it may not even be so young folks. It may be a 30-year-old that may need a lesson on Black history. It may be a 25-year-old, but more or less, I will say this over and over again. If our young folks here in the city of Paterson and many of our urban centers knew what you guys had to go through and what, you know, our other ancestors had to go through to get where we're at now, they would not walk right here with their pants hanging down. They would definitely would not be out here killing each other. And worst of all, they would not understand the importance of education. And if there's one thing during Black History Month, tell them the stories about South Carolina. Tell them the stories about Georgia. Make them understand that, you know, we come from sharecroppers. We came across here not at our own will to be in America, and that they need to understand that. They need to understand that we have a heritage of kings and queens. That's who we are. We are not people just bopping and whopping around the street acting foolish. So they need to understand that. And you may think they know about it, but the true history that you think they're learning in school, they don't know who Frederick Douglass is. They don't know who Harriet Tubman is. They need to know who Vernon Allen is. Yeah. So when they talk at school, they need to understand. And I know recently, you know, people are condemned in the newspaper for their, but the history of our Paterson, of Passaic County, they need to understand. So when history is said and done with, and we talk about Governor Siobhan Sumpter, she just better give me a job. Listen, I'm close to retirement. I got my AARP card now. I'm gonna be hanging up Boston. You gonna be coming to pick me up to go to Atlantic City. I'm gone. I can't live for, I got four sons, so I need to retire real soon. Some scholarships, but I thank you really, really, because so many of you in this room right here have had an impact on my personal life. And I can't thank you guys enough. Ms. Shelby, Ms. Maddie, you guys really raised me. Really raised me and helped me. I come from Paterson. I come from public housing. I come from a single mom. So it takes an entire community to understand what history is. The one thing that the young folks can't say, my mother was single. She had six kids. She made sure I understood my history. She made sure I understood respect. So when I became a teacher, I knew what I had to instill here. I knew that I could visit Ms. Brown down in the kitchen and she fed me some good meals at Eastside High School, because it's all about respect. So please, the one thing that you do during this month, grab them. It may not be your kid, it may not be your grandkid, it may be, you know, the cable man, maybe somebody who don't understand. Talk to them about history. Talk to them about respect. And talk to them that they will understand that we are the legacy of kings and queens. God bless you.
There are sign-in sheets on your tables. Please fill them out, because we need accounts, of course, so Mr. G's can provide an adequate amount of food. Let's give Mr. G's restaurant a round of applause. And the assistant and I both received phone calls from a number of you stating that you didn't know about the event. So if we have your mailing address, write as clearly as possible. We'll make sure you're on our mailing list so that we can inform you of the programs that we have in support of you and in honor of you. Also, I'd like to recognize, oh, Mr. G is here. So Mr. G, if you will give us a wave. There you go. Thank you. You all never have to worry about paying for these events from us. but we need to have good information so that we can send you the invitation and you know where to call in, because it's imperative that we have enough seating. We want you to be comfortable. We don't want you to be sitting on top of each other. We want to make sure we have enough parking, food, all those good things to accommodate you. Also, Commissioner Crystal Cleese from the Patterson School Board is also in the room, and she's running for the fifth ward of the city council as well. And I just need to thank our staff, because the only way that the Assemblymen and I are able to do what we do is the coordination that they provide for our staff. If you'll please just give a wave. And so,
gentlemen in the back, thank you. So we're now turning it over to the Tectones, and let's give them a round of applause. This Every Voice and Sing was publicly performed first as a poem as part of a celebration of Lincoln's birthday on February 12th. 1900 by 500 school children at the segregated Stanton School. Its principal, James Weldon Johnson, wrote the words to introduce its honored guest, Booker T. Washington. The poem was later set to music by Mr. Johnson's brother, John, in 1905. Singing this song quickly became a way for African Americans to demonstrate their patriotism and hope for the future. And calling for earth and heaven to ring with the harmonies of liberty, they could speak out subtly against racism and Jim Crow laws, and especially the huge number of lynchings accompanying the rise of the Ku Klux Klan at the turn of the century. In 1919, the NAACP adopted the song as the Negro National Anthem. By the 1920s, copies of Lift Every Voice and Sing could be found in black churches across the country, often pasted into the hymnals. Now, if you can stand, please stand for the Negro National Anthem. Thank you.
Since 1926, first as Negro History Week and later as Black History Month. We owe the celebration of Black History Month and more importantly, the study of Black history to Dr. Carter G. Woodson. He selected February because it included the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass, whom he believed had dramatically impacted the lives of Black Americans. African Americans are people of music. Songs could be heard out in the cotton fields of the Old South, being sung by the plantation slaves, or in the evenings, coming from their shanty homes. As we take you on a musical journey, we hope you enjoy yourselves while learning the true meaning of the Negro spirituals and what Black history really means.
It is said to have been composed in 1950 by Andres Van Tonder, an elder of the Judas Church. The original composition was in Afrikaans and was subsequently translated into Zulu. In 1978, the Swedish choral group Fejord toured South Africa at the invitation of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of South Africa. Subsequently, this song has been used around the world by schools in their prayers. In 1984, Nyberg arranged Siyahama for a Western four-voice setting and published it in a songbook and recording called Freedom is Coming, Songs of Protest and Praise from South Africa. In 1994, GIA Publications included the song, a hymn book widely used in American Catholic A year later, in the United Church of Christ included the song under the same title, and the New Century Hymn Book. The Unitarian Universalist Association included the song in its 2005 supplement hymn book, Singing the Journey. Today, Siyahama is often performed by children's groups in both sacred and secular environments. Occasionally, the translated lyrics are modified for secular performance. For example, the English translation, "We are marching in the light of God," becomes "We are standing in the light of peace." Thank you.
song in scouting and summer camps, and enjoyed broader popularity during the folk revival of the 1950s and 60s. The song was originally a simple appeal to God to come and help those in need. Kumbaya.
Produced by dancing feet, slaves could decipher these hidden messages. Wade in the Water contained explicit instructions to fugitive slaves on how to avoid capture and the route to take to successfully make their way to freedom. This particular song allegedly recommends leaving dry land and taking to the water as a strategy to grow, pursuing bloodhounds off one's trails.
Let it many spirituals, a sense of wonder, joy, and humility are evident at being in the presence of God, unmatched by the music of any other tradition. All that slaves had to sustain them were God, and those of us who know God should not be at all surprised that a people reduced to such utter brokenness would cry out to the highest being that could save them. The best known use of these rituals in service of freedom during the slave period was the embedding of hidden messages or codes in the song lyrics for the purpose of secret communication on the Underground Railroad.
Calling for even through bondage, have always found solace in music and by giving praises to God. Black History Month is a time to reflect on where we were, how far we've come, and where we're headed. It's a time of reflection and healing. As we continue to celebrate the struggles and triumphs of our ancestors, let's not forget those who are still in the struggle.
Ride on, King Jesus. y'all so far?
Yeah.
We didn't plan on taking you to church this morning, but we know that you all will appreciate it. And especially during this time of Black History Month, Negro spirituals are a central part and at the core of what our founders and what our ancestors have stood upon and made it, that allowed them to make their way through. So just give it up for the students this morning.
The song, We Will Overcome, was published in the September 1948 issue of People's Songs Bulletin. The song initially was derived from the Food and Tobacco Workers Union. According to the late Pete Seeger, the song is thought to have become associated with the Civil Rights Movement from 1959, when Guy Carawan stepped in as song leader at Highlander, which was then focused on nonviolent civil rights activism. Seeger states the song quickly became the movement's unofficial anthem. Pete Seeger and other famous folk singers in the early 1960s, such as Joan Baez, sang the song at rallies, folk festivals, and concerts in the North and helped make it widely known. Since its rise to prominence, the song and songs based on it have been used in a variety of protests worldwide.
Thank you.
on every year. I appreciate all of you. How many graduating seniors we have here?
Oh,
nice. Give them a round of applause, graduating seniors. And they have been with us. They have been with us through the year, so let's wish them well. We're going to feed them now. I want to thank you all for coming. There's also a Deborah Major here. It's her birthday. Come here. All right, here she goes. Director, Ms. Irma